Good morning, everybody. Let's stand together, begin our service with singing this morning. Praise Him, praise Him. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Let's sing. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of His Spirit and washed in His blood. This is my story. You may be seated.
Good to see you all in church this morning. God bless you that are here in the auditorium, and God bless you that are home watching on live stream. It's the first time in a few weeks I've been able to be here, and it feels good. Amen. I had to take a pair of scissors this morning and go clip here and try to look halfway decent, act like a preacher. Amen. But good to see you all. Welcome. It does feel good to be here, to hear the singing. Again, our fellowship is minimized a little bit. We can't hug and shake hands, you know, that kind of thing. And that's wisdom that says to do that. But I look forward to the preaching of the Word of God. I thank God for the live stream, to be able to sit in my office and watch the services each time here. Matter of fact, Wednesday night, they had a bunch of men come up here and pray for our country and our missionaries and pray for the foolishness that's going on in our country. And I cried a little bit in my office, you know, as I listened to the men pray, because I know Christ is the only answer. Here to give you some announcements. Next Sunday, we're supposed to have a bunch of folks get baptized last Sunday, but I wasn't here. So next Sunday, we're rescheduling, and we have a lot of folks lined up to be baptized. They've trusted Christ, and I want to identify with him publicly. So I'm looking forward to that day next Sunday. Also, next Sunday, we might have a couple little grandbabies to dedicate. Bonnie Viss is over there, and a couple of her grandchildren live way across the other side of town, but the parents want to dedicate them to the Lord. So I hope to have an opportunity to talk to those parents this week. So pray for me as I talk to them. I'm trying to think. This week was supposed to be the beginning of our missions conference. This whole week here, we had four or five missionaries coming in from different places. But we thought it wise. We thought it'd be hard to get folks here for several nights in a row. And we thought it may be unwise to bring these missionaries in, expose them to some of these things. So we put that off. I have a message ready, and you're going to get it next week, about how Jesus loves the whole world. Amen. Amen? And we get to be a part about Jesus loving the whole world. So it's still a message I'm looking forward to preaching. You know, it's been amazing to me. Last week we canceled our Sunday school hour, because we had so many teachers that were sick and so many staff around here, and I were one of them, amen? And I don't have to worry about getting the virus no more, amen? But I don't want to pass it on to anybody. It has absolutely been amazing to me to watch the media and people change their mind day to day, what's happening, what's not happening. I think I'm smarter than all of them right now, amen? I can tell you what to do and what not to do. I know people that live in the same home, some of them get severely sick. Some of them get sick for a couple days and they're over it. And one's walking around like nothing ever happened. Amen? So it affects everybody differently. And you know, if I survive this virus, something else is going to get me. Amen? But I have this wonderful peace. I really do. I have this wonderful peace. I don't like being sick. We're going to pray for the sick here in just a minute. But I have this wonderful peace that God, through his Son, Jesus Christ, has overcome sickness and death and everything. And my heart breaks for people who don't get that. I can't imagine going through this and they think all life is this 70 or 80 years, and that's the whole ball of wax. And they don't have the hope of eternal life. One day, the Bible talks so much about heaven, but it talks about a new heaven and a new earth. We're gonna be on this earth with sinless bodies and no sin, ruling and reigning with Christ. Sorry to take up preaching time, Ron, but it's been 3 weeks, man. Gee. You know? But it is amazing how this virus affects people so many different ways. Our plans are to open our school, our Christian school, in 3 weeks. And people feel different ways about it. And I was reading something the other day. American Medical Association says there's much greater chance of a child dying of the common influenza than this virus. We're going to have school. We're going to do the best and be wise as we can. But life has to move on. My heart breaks. My heart is breaking for people who are losing their businesses and their homes and their livelihoods. And it seems like the people that are most critical are the people in the media and the politicians who haven't lost a paycheck yet. And they go home to their gated communities. Now, the Bible talks about us all suffering together. If you're going to run your mouth, you need to suffer with the brethren, amen? Sorry, I've been doing my best not to be political, to lift up the name of Christ. But when you suffer with us, then you can talk. But I thank you that you're here. This season in the world right now, I don't know how long God will permit it, But God, people will never be able to say to God that God didn't try to do something to get our attention to turn us back to Him. It's absolutely amazing how we will not turn back to God, the Creator and our Savior. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the folks that are here today. I know so many others long to be here. It is a wonderful thing. There's just something, after 3 weeks, there's something about being with my brothers and sisters. I still can't hug them. I can't grab their hand and shake their hand and chat with them closely. There's something about that fellowship, dear God, being close one another. And I thank you for it. And I look so much forward to it in the future, dear God, when all this is past. I thank you for the singing of your word. Those who lift up your name and song, and we exalt who you are, dear God. And I look forward to the preaching today because my heart's ready. I've come expecting something. I'm coming looking for something, dear God. My flesh is out of the way. I pray for the sick, dear God, not just those with the virus. I pray for many who have cancer and many diseases, dear God. And I've gone through a little time of this, and it's such an easy time to become depressed and dejected, dear God. Not having purpose in your life, just sort of getting from day to day, from evening to the morning, dear God. I pray for the sick. I'm so acutely aware now how hard it is to be sick, dear God, and to praise your name. Think of my old grandma years ago who sat in a nursing home with just such suffering, dear God. And I remember her saying, dear God, I don't know why, Danny. I don't know why God still has me here, but I trust him. Oh, dear God, help us to trust you even in our sickness, dear God. Help us to be like Job, who said, though he slay me, I will trust him. Oh, dear God, your purpose for our lives is perfect. I pray for those in the medical field. They're exalted many times, but quickly they're soon forgotten. I pray for them, dear God, as they have to minister to people and see brokenness and sickness and suffering and death. May you give them tender hearts. May you give them safety as they go home each night, dear Lord. Again, I pray for the business owners and those who have lost their jobs and are losing so many things, dear God, and people seem so insensitive to what they're going through. Lift them up, dear God. Give wisdom to our leaders, our president, our governors, dear God. I pray you would shut the mouth of the wicked media who causes division among people, dear God. We are a disunified country. This is a very unusual time. I pray you would shut their mouths and teach them, dear God. Dear God, I so many things here today. I pray for our pastors in our country. This is the time to stand to proclaim who you are. Speak out against sin. Sin has caused all of this, dear Lord. Dear God, help our church to be a loving church. May we stand on the truth, dear Lord. But maybe people look at our lives, and even though we try not to sin, and we stumble sometimes, we preach against sin, we challenge people not to sin, may they realize that we dearly love them and that we are sinners just like them. We just have the saving grace of Jesus Christ. So many things I want to say, dear God, today, but we need your help. We desperately need your help. We need to open our eyes and open our ears to your word and let it convict us. My heart breaks for those who don't have Christ today. Your dear son, who have no hope, who are just groping in the darkness looking for an answer, dear God. Bless their dear lives, and may they be drawn by your love to your forgiveness. I pray these things. Bless today. May your name be lifted up. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Ushers, come on up. Yeah, you can come on and do that. See, I forgot. We take offerings around here. You take it, Brother Leroy.
All right, we're going to ask the ushers, if they will, to come at this time. And this is the opportunity where we take a part of our life in the form of a check or money, and we place it in the offering plate, thanking God for what he's done for us. When we give of ourselves to our employer, we give them our life, and they in turn give us the money to live and to operate. And so now we give this back to God. as an offering unto him and thanking him for his good pleasure upon our lives. Father, thank you that we can give back to you what you've so graciously given to us. And Father, let this be a token of our love and appreciation for all that you've done for us. Even though you've commanded your word for us to do this, but we also give above that which you have told us to do. And again, that's an expression of our love to you. And Father, we never want to forget what you've done for us upon the cross of Calvary in giving us eternal life through the shedding of your blood. Thank you again for your love, and thank you again for your provisions. We ask these things in your blessed name. Amen. Thank you for the offering.
God is so worthy of our thoughts, our love this morning. Let's stand and sing from our hearts unto him. I will sing of my Redeemer.
I will sing of my Redeemer and his wondrous love to me. On the cruel cross he suffered from the curse to set me free. Sing, oh sing. My Redeemer and his
us to sing the first and last verse of "Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus."
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust Thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that You are with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus,
thank you. You may be seated.
I believe in the Son. I believe in the risen One. I believe I overcome by the power of His blood. Amen. Amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends, because He lives. I was dead in the grave. I was covered in sin and shame, but I heard mercy call my name. He rolled the stone away. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Amen. Let my song join the one that never ends. Amen. Amen. I'm alive. I'm alive because He lives. Amen. Join the one that never ends, because He lives, because He lives.
Jesus Christ hadn't saved you. Let's stand together one more time and sing this chorus before the preaching.
Take your Bibles, if you will, and go ahead and turn to Luke chapter 12. We'll get there in just a moment. I think, Pastor, they're ready for you to be back. I don't know where he's sitting now. Is he in the back? Or there he is over there. Sermon number 2, all right? I appreciate all of those that are here and appreciate the cooperation that everybody has done. I know that everybody feels a little bit different about the social distancing and the mask and all that kind of things, but I appreciate the fact that we're concerned with others as well as ourselves, and so we want to be cognizant of the fact that others have needs and desires. And so thank you so much for being here and taking care. Those of you that are watching at home, appreciate you being and watching online. We've got a large group that watch every week and appreciate that, and hopefully you received a blessing from it. Once again, I do want to comment and say thank you to our crew, our media crew that has taken care of making sure that the services run and do well. I appreciate that. Once all this is over with, we're going to have them up here and feed them a steak dinner or something, courtesy of Brother Carlos is going to take care of that. But I appreciate everybody that's here. There's a character, and I really, when I began studying this particular sermon, I thought about one particular person, and the older people that are here, the more seasoned people that are here will remember this, there was a man that was one of the wealthiest men in the world, very, very famous. He was involved in movies as far as directing and producing them, and then he was later on in his life involved in aviation and producing airplanes, and then he became very eccentric in the last about 20 years of his life. And most of you that probably already realize who I'm talking about. Howard Hughes was the man's name. He had all the kind of wealth that he needed. He was very wealthy, very powerful, very popular, but yet he still was a recluse. He didn't have the peace that we can find in Jesus Christ. Too many times people think that the powerful and the wealthy and those things that are the people that are popular, look at their life, isn't it just great? But it's the rare occasion that people like that live in peace and happiness. Most of the time they're dissatisfied. If they do not know the Lord Jesus Christ, we know where that comes from. There's a great need in everyone's life. And that need that is out there can only be filled by Jesus Christ. And so there's that hole in everyone's life that's there. Jesus, when he was here on this earth, he talked to so many different types of people. And he was involved in giving out the message of salvation that came through his sacrifice that was going to occur. His disciples, he repeatedly told them over and over again that he came to die for the sins of the world, and he was going to rise again after 3 days. All of that was given as part of what his ministry was. And there were many critics that were out there. In fact, the religious leaders of the day were the biggest critics that he had. Looking at Luke chapter number 12, we're going to go back to chapter number 11 and read the last couple of verses of chapter number 11. Verse number 53 and 54, the scripture says, "And as he said these things unto them, the scribes and the Pharisees began to urge him vehemently and to provoke him to speak of many things." They wanted to catch him in his thoughts and in the things that he was saying. Verse number 54, "laying wait for him and seeking to catch something out of his mouth that they might accuse him." And so this kind of sets the stage for what's coming in chapter number 12. That we're going to get into in just a moment. Ultimately, our life is wrapped up in what
the physical side of things. We know that we have houses, we may have cars, we may have some money in the bank, some may have popularity, some may have things in their life, but that's only the physical thing. That's just the physical. We know that God stresses on the inside, the spiritual, the soul of mankind, because the physical is going to pass away one of these days. And all that's going to be left is that soul of mankind that exists to fellowship with God. And that opportunity for us as Christians to have that life after this physical life is over with is something that we look forward to. The older we get, the more we look forward to it. The more aches and pains we have in the morning when we get up, the more we look forward to that day. Brother Rockwell mentioned it, and Pastor mentioned it, both of them did, about, you know, one of these days, all those aches and pains are going to go away because we're going to be with God in heaven. All of those things that are important to us in this physical life will be gone. God addresses that. Jesus Christ addresses that in chapter number 12 of Luke, and I want to go into that. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for how it speaks to our heart and our life, and Father, gives us instruction. And Father, there's message here for everyone, message for the lost world, a message for those Christians that are here that need encouragement and uplifting and maybe be going through struggles in their own life that they're having a difficulty with. Father, you're there for us. And so, Father, help your word to bring forth and be clarity in our life. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In this life, it's hard to separate the physical from the spiritual because the physical is what we see. We see us. We see these pews. We see the platform. We see those things that are physical before our eyes. And sometimes we forget that there's more to life than these physical things. Chapter number 12, verse 1, let's begin there. In the meantime, talking about right after those last two verses that we read, that the scribes and the Pharisees were trying to catch Jesus in something that he said so that they could accuse him. In the meantime, when there were gathered together an innumerable multitude of people, insomuch that they trod one upon another, they wanted to crowd around Jesus Christ. So he's got a big congregation of people that's going to listen to him. He began to say unto his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. After all of these things that the Pharisees were urging him to speak, he began to speak, and the very first words out of his mouth was, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. They're hypocrites. What is hypocrisy? Hypocrisy has to do with saying one thing and living something else. That's what hypocrisy is. That was the pinnacle of who the Pharisees and the scribes were. They claimed to be people of God. They claimed to have that part of them that wanted to obey God, but in fact, inside their heart, as Jesus Christ declared in other passages, they're like whited sepulchers. They're good, nice and white on the inside, but outside, but on the inside, they're full of dead men's bones. Because that was a declaration of who the scribes and the Pharisees were. And he said, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. He says, what does that mean to the disciples? He's talking to the 12, but he's talking to this congregation as well. And he's talking to the Pharisees that are out there. What he's saying is, be genuine. Be transparent. Be real. If there's anything that I would desire of Eastland Baptist Church and our pastors and the staff, is that we would be real. Frequently we mention that we're not perfect. We make mistakes. During all of this pandemic, we've made decisions, and not all of them probably have been right, and not all of them have things that people agree with. That's fine. We're going to do that because we're imperfect creatures. From the top down, we are men that are human and women that are human. And if we understand that there are things that are there, we have to be transparent and say, hey, God works on me as well as he works on anybody else. When a preacher gets up here to preach, if he hasn't preached the sermon to himself first, then he hasn't done a good job. Pastor Green frequently says, when I get down for him, the hard part is when I've got to live what I just preached. And that's the truth. There is a burden that rests upon the men of God that preach and that stand before you and that teach. And that is that we would be faithful to God, but we would be genuine. I like the fact that in our church, listen to this, our staff is approachable. That is not the way it is everywhere. You want to talk to the pastor during non-pandemic times. You'll have to run from him to keep him from shaking your hands out there. Why? Because we're approachable. We need to be. We need to be real. When he was talking to his disciples, he says, you be real. Don't be a hypocrite. Don't be like the scribes and the Pharisees. But he's talking about genuine Christians too, those that are not in leadership. By the way, there's no separate standard for us as for you. You need to be genuine. You need to be real in your life. And so when he talks about the leaven of the Pharisees, he's talking about that hypocrisy. Verse 2, for there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed, neither hid that shall not be known. There is nothing, you cannot pull the wool over God's eyes. You're not capable of doing that. He knows everything. He understands. Verse number 3, therefore whatsoever ye have spoken in darkness shall be heard in the light, and that which ye have spoken in the ear in the closet shall be proclaimed upon the housetops. There's going to be some comparison. If you want to take your finger and leave it there and keep your finger, we're going to go to several different passages, but we're going to go back and forth between Ecclesiastes. The comparison in Luke chapter 12 and Ecclesiastes is amazing. But we're going to go to Ecclesiastes chapter number 12 and verse 14. In Ecclesiastes chapter 12 verse 14, the scripture says, for God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. We don't hide anything from God. In fact, think about prayer for a minute. When you get on your knees to pray and you start telling God something, God, I have this problem. God, I have this difficulty. I have a desire. Or maybe you're praying for somebody else. Whatever it might be in that prayer, you realize you're not telling God anything that he doesn't already know. God already knows the difficulties in our life that we're going through. Why? You have to be real in your prayer life. That's one of the most important parts of prayer, is that you're honest with yourself, because you cannot be dishonest with God. He already knows. So be real, be genuine. Those things will be revealed at one day. Romans chapter 2 and verse 16 says, in the days when God shall judge the secrets of men by Jesus Christ according to the gospel. You see, everything's going to be opened up. Everything's going to be opened up. Turn back over to Luke chapter number 12, if you will. Begins to speak to the disciples once again. Verse number 4, and I say unto you, my friends, be not afraid of them that kill the body, and after that they have no more that they can do. Isn't that a statement? Man, if the only thing they can do is kill this body, they can't do a whole lot to Christians. Because once this body is gone, we're with God in heaven. What did Stephen say when they were stoning him? His eyes gazing up, he says he saw Jesus Christ on the right hand of the Father. He was ready to accept Stephen, the very first Christian martyr. What's the worst you can do? Kill me and then I'll be going to be with God? That's not punishment. That's understanding who God is and what he's done for me. Verse 5, but I will forewarn you whom ye shall fear. Fear him which after he hath killed hath power to cast into hell. Yea, I say unto you, fear him. Fear God. God is the one that ultimately has our eternity in his hands. When you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, we know what happens in that eternity. It says, and my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give unto them eternal life. John chapter number 10. Read that passage right there. And ye shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck you out of my hand. The Father that gave them me is greater than all. No man can take them out of the Father's hand. And then he says, I and my Father are one. Jesus Christ is God. And he keeps us safe. Verse number 6. Are not 5 sparrows sold for 2 farthings, and not one of them is forgotten before God? But even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, ye are of more value than many sparrows. My wife and I have got this habit. And Brother Fleming, if you don't see us out on the road, it's because you're coming at the wrong time, okay? We walk 2 miles, and we go out on Curry Ford Road and go down a mile and then come back every morning. And the birds are out there chirping. The wildlife is out there. I think we saw an armadillo in one of the holes one time. All of those things, those are all God's creatures. And Jesus Christ is saying, aren't you more important than all of them? I see Fred and Ethel. the two sandhill cranes out in the middle of the that's what we've called them, okay? And they're out there picking at the insects that are there. And what? You think God didn't provide the insects and the grass and the things for them to graze on? Oh, yeah, he takes care of them. Why? Because they're important. They're part of his creatures. How much more are we important to God? Verse number 13, skip down. Becomes this, this young man that comes to Jesus and asks him a question. One of the company said unto him, Master, speak to my brother that he divide the inheritance with me. We're not shifting gears here. It's all in the same vein that we're talking about Jesus Christ and our soul and how he takes care of our soul. And this young man comes to Jesus and says, come help judge between me and my brother. He's not giving me my inheritance. And you go back to Deuteronomy and you find out that the oldest son gets double portion of the inheritance. And so that's the law that's laid out in the Old Testament. So I don't know if this is the case, but I can just see this being the younger son that says, I only got half of what he got. And then he goes on, he says, and he said unto him, Jesus says unto him, verse 14, Man, who may be a judge or a divider over you? The law was already there. But there was a problem in this young man's life, and it wasn't the lack of the inheritance coming to him. It was the fact that he desired more and more. Look at verse number 15, and he said unto him, Take heed and beware of covetousness. Beware, that's a caution that's there. Beware of coveting more and more. By the way, all of this is going to be gone. Why covet more and more of it? Paul in his writing says, In having food and raiment, let us therewith be content. Book of Matthew, Jesus Christ says, He gives you food and he clothes you better than the flowers of the field. So God provides our food and raiment. We ought to be content. I've taken two missionary trips to areas where they were very impoverished. One of the areas was down just south of Mexico City in Cuernavaca, Mexico. At the time in 1992, I believe, was the year we went down there. 1992, and I watched as we as Americans, we think of our poorest is rich in the rest of the world, by the way. But I watched as this lady would clean our hotel room every night. We had a missions conference down there. Instead of missionaries coming to the churches, this particular missionary invited pastors and people from churches down to see the mission field firsthand, and so that's why we were there. And this lady that was taking care, we were staying at the same hotel there in Cuernavaca, and this lady didn't have a mop. She had a stick with a towel tied to it, and she would use that to mop the floor and clean it. She was very conscientious, worked hard. At the end of the 7 days that we were there, we were there, and the music director of the church was there in the room right next to him and his wife, and Janice and I. And we said, well, what would be good as a tip to leave this lady for the week? Because she had gotten water for us and done other things for us. We thought we'd leave her a track and leave her a tip. And so we talked about it, and we said, well, we'll give her $7, a dollar for each day. And they were going to give her $7, so that she ended up, that little tip was $14 that were there. Gave it to the lady and with the track, and all of a sudden, none of us spoke Spanish, and the lady just burst out into tears. And we thought, well, we've done something wrong. We've offended her or something, and we don't know. We got on the bus to head back to Mexico City, and we started talking to the missionary's daughter that was there, told her what we had done. She said, you don't understand. You gave her a month full worth of salary. And the poor, she was happy. She seemed very happy in what she was doing. She probably had food and clothes. She now had a track from us about, Spanish track about Jesus Christ. Back a few years ago, after the earthquake, went down to Haiti and went through Port-au-Prince. And as we were driving through Port-au-Prince, there were buildings collapsed everywhere. And I still remember this as we were driving down one of the main roads of Port-au-Prince. Over on this side, a building had collapsed. The wall had totally just collapsed down. And you could see the second floor tilted like this. And there was a whole group of people on that second floor. And they were clapping and singing. And we asked the missionary, who said, that's a Baptist church, and they're having a service. And they're in that broken building after that earthquake, clapping and singing and rejoicing that God had saved them from the struggle that they were going through at that time. We don't realize the struggle other people go through. And we complain. And we want more. We want to be have more of what this earthly goods are. This life is not about the earthly goods. It's about having Jesus Christ and sharing Him with others and being content in what we have and being happy with what God has given us in our life. He gave us a parable. First of all, I'm going to finish verse number 15. It says, "For a man's life consisteth not in the abundance of the things which he possesseth." That's a mouthful. Our life is not wrapped up in what we have or who we are. It's wrapped up in Jesus Christ. He spake a parable unto them, saying, "The ground of a certain rich man brought forth plentiful. And he thought within himself," verse number 17, "saying, what shall I do? Because I have no more room where to bestow my fruits. And he said this will I do. I will pull down my barns and build greater, and there will I bestow all of my fruits and my goods." His problem was he didn't identify that the blessings that he had were from God Almighty. They were not his fruits. They were not his goods. He had not done them on his own. Yeah, he may have gone out there and tilled the ground or hired somebody to till the ground, but he wouldn't have gotten anything without the rain and the sunshine and the prosperity that God gave. Sometimes we get wrapped up in the fact that, oh, we're good at what we do, and what we have is based upon what we have done. No, it's the blessings of God. What we have is a blessing from God. We identify this as not I and my, but His. And by the way, those goods were not His. Think about this for a minute. Those goods, those crops that came in did not belong to Him. The things that we have don't belong to us. We're just stewards of them. God has lent them to us for us to be a blessing to others and a blessing to those around us. That's what we have. We have what is God's and belongs to Him. Tithing is not about giving a tenth of something that we have. Tithing is about giving a tenth back of what God has already given us. That's what God does. God gives us everything. So he decides he's going to build bigger barns. Here's where a lack of satisfaction comes in. He was not satisfied with what he had. Christians, we're supposed to be satisfied. We're supposed to have the opportunity to realize that what God blesses us with, we ought to take and say, "Thank you, Lord. I'm not worthy of it anyway." But we see ourself wrapped up in what we have. Our houses, our cars, and those things that we have. And this is not primarily about substance and about those kinds. What it is about is that we understand the fact that our soul and our spirit, what's on the inside is what's important. The blessings of God. By the way, Lord Terry's is coming. We're all going to get sick. We are. You're not going to stay healthy for the next 100 years. You're going to get sick. I'm going to get sick. And within the next 100 years, I'm sure I'm going to die if the Lord tarries his coming. I really don't want to be 165, okay? I know that's going to happen. So this life is more than just the air that I breathe and the body that I have and the health that I have and the possessions that I have. There's more to life than that. And it's not about talking about things. It's talking about this thing on the inside, that our soul needs to commune with God. Our soul needs to be right with God, because that's a special thing that God has given each one of us. So let's forget about all this other junk that's out there. And where are we spiritually with God? Where are we spiritually with God? Because everything else really doesn't matter. The parable goes on. But I want to interject here. If you've got your finger held in Ecclesiastes, turn back over to Ecclesiastes chapter number 6, if you will. Ecclesiastes chapter number 6, we're going to read 3 verses there. Verse number 7 says, "All the labor of man is for his mouth, and yet the appetite is not full. Well, I don't know that he's talking about food here. But all the labor of man, our appetite is not full. The more we have is not make us satisfied, it's the more we want. For what hath the wise more than the fool? Hath the poor that knoweth to walk before the living? Better is the sight of the eyes than the wandering of the desire. This is also vanity and vexation of spirit. Ecclesiastes, the whole book is about Solomon taking the opportunity to look and see what the meaning of life is about, what makes people happy. And he's come to this point in chapter number 6, and he says, man, the more I eat, the more I want. The more I have, the more I desire. What is that? That's covetousness. Well, over in the book of Luke, chapter 12, what it was the problem? It was covetousness with this young man. It wasn't that he didn't have enough. He probably had half of the inheritance, but he wanted more. Too many times we want more out of this life than what we should be getting to be satisfied. I read about Howard Hughes and his life. And he was very wealthy, but that wealth did not make him satisfied at all. In his later life, he had desires that could not be met. He was afraid of people. He was exclusive from other people. He would stay away from them. He had no fellowship with his family. And he's not alone in that. There's a lot of people that are lonely because they don't have the understanding that life is more than the abundance of things that we possess. Back over in Luke chapter number 12, if you will. Here's this man that has had a great crop one year, and he says, I'm going to have even a better crop next year. In verse number 19, it says, I will say to my soul, so thou hast much goods laid up for many years. Take thine ease, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said unto him, thou fool. And by the way, that's the same foolishness that you find in Ecclesiastes, the word vanity, the emptiness of life. Thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. Then whose shall those things be which thou hast provided? Heap up treasures on this earth. Get things together, and when you die, you leave it to somebody else. And most of the families that I have seen fight over what's left. There's no satisfaction there. Back over in Ecclesiastes chapter 2, what am I saying? These two chapters, the book of Ecclesiastes and chapter 12 of Luke, compare Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 18. Yea, I halted all my labor which I had taken under the sun. This is Solomon speaking. Because I should leave it unto the man that shall be after me. And who knoweth whether he shall be a wise man or a fool? Yet shall he have rule over all my labor wherein I've labored and wherein I have showed myself wise under the sun. This is also vanity or foolishness. Yeah, Solomon realized the same thing. Back over in chapter 12, verse 21 of Luke. So is he that layeth up treasure for himself and is not rich toward God. Here's the thing. We have an opportunity in this life to live our life for God. To stand up and do the things that would be pleasing in God's sight. We'll get to the ultimate end of this matter here at the end of the message. But we have that opportunity to store up treasure in heaven. Where moth and rust does not corrupt. Where thieves don't break through and steal. In James chapter number 4, verse 13, Scripture says, go to now ye that say today or tomorrow, we will go into such a city and continue there a year and buy and sell and get gain, whereas ye know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. For that you ought to say, as if the Lord will, we shall live and do this or that. But now you're rejoicing in your boastings. All such rejoicing. Oh no, all such rejoicing is evil. You start complaining about what you don't have and what you want to get more. By the way, what do you want out of your life? What is your desire in this life? Let's, let's forget about substance for a minute. Let's forget about things, material goods, because it's just stuff anyway. But what is your goals? What do you desire in your life? There's been a lot of talk recently about legacy. And I guess that's kind of what I'm thinking about here is, what do you want your legacy to be? What do you want people to say after your life is over with? What do you want left for those that are here? Maybe you want to give the word of God to those who do not have it, so that when you die, when you're gone, when God takes you home, that you have some people here that are carrying on the work of God, that are doing what's right. Maybe your family, you need to witness to your family. You need to give them the gospel. The hardest thing in the world is to witness to family. It really is. But your family needs to know the gospel of Jesus Christ. What are you going to leave? What is your goal? You know what I see in the world? I'm a list person. I like to take and write down a list and then check them off. If I do something that's not on my list, I'll write it on there just so I can check it off. You know, that's the kind of list person I am. Anybody else like that? And so when I start my day, I don't wonder about what I'm going to do. I've got something in front of me for me to do because it's a task, a goal that's out there. Now, I don't get everything done that I'm supposed to get done on my list, but I understand that I have something to look forward to. What I see in the world is a lot of people, not everybody, but there's a lot of people that have absolutely no motivation and no goal for getting up in the morning. And it's really tough when you don't have anywhere to go because you can't go to work, right? We're in the middle of this. Don't come to work. You know, you got to stay at home. What's your motivation? I think sometimes I wonder if the whole population of the United States doesn't spend the whole day in their pajamas, you know? Be motivated in something. But as Christians, we ought to be motivated to make a difference in this world and store up treasure in heaven, because that's what's going to last. I've got so much here. In Psalm 10, the 10th Psalm, verse number 2 says, "The wicked in his pride doth persecute the poor. Let them be taken in the devices that they have imagined. For the wicked boasteth of his heart's desire, and blesseth the covetous whom the Lord abhorreth." God doesn't want us to have desires of the flesh that continually desire the things of this world. The wicked, through the pride of his countenance, will not seek after God. God is not at all in his thoughts. Look at verse 6. He has said in his heart, "I shall not be moved, for I shall never be in adversity." Verse 11. He has said in his heart, "God hath forgotten. He hideth his face. He will never see it." That's what the world says, is that there is no God, and if he's there, he doesn't care what I'm doing. So they're going to live life for themselves. What was that beer commercial years ago? Grab all the gusto because you only go around once. Problem is, there's going to be a place where you're going to exist after this once. A home in heaven or a home in eternal hell. You're going to go around again. Make preparation for it. Back over in Luke chapter number 12, if you will. Look at verse number 23. Scripture says this: "The life is more than meat, and the body is more than raiment." Make sure you understand that there's more to this than the physical. Verse 27 says, "Consider the lilies of the valley." Consider. Verse number 28, at the end it says, "O ye of little faith." We have no faith that God can take care of our needs. That's a lack of trusting God for the very basics of this world. You realize that the very breath that you're breathing right now comes from God? And you can't have faith enough to think that you're going to have more of that breath, because, by the way, that breath ends one day. And so I have to depend upon God for the very breath, for the heart beating, for all of the things in this life. Oh, ye of little faith, don't you think he can take care of you? Trusting Jesus Christ for the things of life, the things that we have need of in this world, trusting Jesus Christ, if you've trusted him as your personal Savior, if you're here this morning, you've never accepted Christ, you need to trust Christ as your Savior. Your eternal soul you've placed in God's care, in His lockbox, and He's keeping you. You're not keeping yourself safe, He's keeping you saved. So you've entrusted the most important thing in your life to Him. How come we can't trust Him for the little things of this world? How come we can't trust Him for the food on our table, the clothes on our back? The answer is we can. We just need to have faith. Faith, the same kind of faith we had when we trusted Him for our soul. Well, let's look at the end of it. Luke chapter 12, verse 31. Then we're going to go back to Ecclesiastes. Luke 12, verse 31. But rather seek ye the kingdom of God, and all these things shall be added unto you. Seek ye first, another passage, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all of these things shall be added unto you. Back over in Ecclesiastes chapter number 12. After everything was written in Ecclesiastes about seeking for more stuff, which that's what Solomon wanted. He wanted more. And by the way, he was probably the wealthiest man in the world at the time. He tried to solve his desire for more with pleasure. You read through the whole passage, and he tried everything under the sun. And what he found out, it was all emptiness. And then he came down to the last two verses of the whole book, chapter number 12, verse 13 and 14. Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep His commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God shall bring every work into judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. The ultimate end of understanding who we are, that is our soul and our spirit, the things that are not physical, that we cannot see, but we know are there. The ultimate end of taking care of the soul and spirit of man is to fear God and keep His commandments. My God makes it hard, doesn't He? He says there's just two things. Fear God and keep His commandments. It's simple, but it's so hard for us who are mortal to give over to God those things that we want to hold on to. We want to hold the treasures of this world. We want to hold on to our health. All of those are going to be gone. We want to hold on to the temporal. The things, by the way, the word temporal comes from temporary instead of the eternal. The eternal nature of mankind is to fear God and to keep His commandments. That's what God wants from us. He doesn't want us to be covetous. He doesn't want us to seek more of the world, of popularity, or the fame, or the power, or the money. He wants us to fear Him and keep His commandments. Because one of these days we're going to face Him and nothing's going to be hid. It's all going to be open. And God wants us to be faithful to Him. You want to have satisfaction? There's a song that was playing both before Sunday school and church. You know how I like to sing, right? The word is satisfied. The song. All my life long I had panted for a drink from some cool spring that I hoped would quench the burning of the thirst I felt within. Hallelujah, I have found Him whom my soul so long had craved. Jesus satisfies my longings. Through His blood I now am saved. Poor I was and sought for riches, something that would satisfy. But the dust I gathered round me only mocked my soul's sad cry. Hallelujah, I have found Him whom my soul so long has craved. Jesus satisfies my longings. Through His blood I now am saved. This is the only thing that can satisfy the missing part in our life. and that's Jesus Christ. Fear God and keep His commandments. Let's pray. Father, thank You so much for Your word. Father, be with us today. Father, we know that the world out there would just try to drive us toward possessions and things in this world that are not important to You. All of that will be gone one day, and all that's left is what we do for You. So, Father, help us to seek us first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Father, we realize that those eternal things, those values of this life are important to You. So, Father, help us to push aside and trust You for the necessities of life, but realize that there's something You want for us to do in this life, and that is to care for others, to fear You, and keep Your commandments. Father, help us today, in Jesus' name. With every head bowed and every eye closed, we're going to have an opportunity to make a decision for Jesus Christ. Maybe you're here and you know you've accepted Christ as your Savior, but there's something in your life that you're struggling with, something that you need prayer for. Maybe totally unrelated to the message this morning, but it's something that God has laid on your heart. You have a need and a desire. When we go to prayer in a minute, Christian, you want me to pray with you about it. It's between you and God, but I'll come and I'll pray for you. If you have a need, if you'd lift your hand at this time, I'd pray for you all across the congregation. As I see those hands in each section. God bless you. You can put your hands down. Thank you so much. I know that this is an opportunity. We have few in number here, but maybe there's someone this morning that has never taken that opportunity to trust Christ as their Savior. You would say this morning, I would like to have Christ on my side. I want to be one of His children. I want to accept Him as my Savior. I've never had that time in my life where I've asked Him to forgive me of my sins and to save me. Preacher, I want to do that this morning. If you would raise your hand, I'll pray for you, but I'll also help you. Anyone like that? If you're at home watching by way of streaming, I'll have a prayer here in just a moment. And if you don't know the Lord as your Savior, why don't you take that opportunity right now in your living room to get on your knees and ask Jesus Christ to save you. Father, we come before You this morning. Father, I pray that You would be with our people. I know we're going through a difficult time in our country and with our church. And Father, I pray that we would realize the important things of this life are not the physical, but it's the spiritual. It's seeking You first, fearing You and keeping Your commandments. Father, I pray for those that raise their hand. I don't know what their needs are, but You're a God that's eternal and You know everything. So Father, I pray that You would be with them this morning. Father, I pray for anyone that doesn't know Christ as their Savior. Father, I pray that they would just pray this simple prayer. God, I'm a sinner, and I realize I cannot save myself, but I realize that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins, and I claim that sacrifice for my sins, and I accept Him today as my Savior. If you prayed that, I pray that you would let us know that you've accepted Christ this morning. Father, thank You so much for what You do for us and the church You've given us to worship You in. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's stand together. We're going to sing a verse of invitation. If you have need this morning to come and pray, it's what the altar's up here for. We have these steps up here that you can kneel and you can pray and take care of the needs as we sing. Let's sing together. Let's bow our heads as we sing one more verse. Maybe you want to step out when no one's looking, and just a private thing between you and God. Let's sing one more verse, and if God's dealing with you, why don't you come?
All to Jesus I surrender.
Humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken. Take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Thank you. You may be seated just for a couple of minutes as we make just a couple of other announcements. There will be no Bible studies again this week, so be back tonight at 6 o'clock for a message. Looking forward to that service. So be back in our Wednesday night service at 7 o'clock. We're going through about 4 or 5 missionaries every Wednesday night. And given an idea, we have 70 missionaries and missionary projects that we are going through. And we pray for them and pray for our country, pray for those needs that we have in our church. So be back Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. There's a lot of bread that's back here on the bread table. So before you leave, go back there and take a bag of carbs home with you, would you? All right. Well, gonna finish the service with a song, "Thank You, Lord, for Saving My Soul." Come and lead us, Brother Cheston. Tonight at 6 o'clock, and we're dismissed from this place.